this morning's session is slightly different because today I decided to speak on the works of Thomas Tronstrom, the son of the soil of Sweden, a country that has given many intelligent ones. It has given Carl Gustav Jung, the psychologist, who is one of the main pillars of modern psychology, along with Sigmund Freud and Esmeri. And not only that, it was Carl Jung, who was a medical practitioner as well as a psychologist, said in 40 years of my medical practice, I have come to the conclusion that after the age of 40, if somehow the religion is given to the people, they can be saved. It was Carl Jung who introduced the concept of collective unconsciousness. And today, the world celebrates the life and work of another Swede, Thomas Tronstrom, who also by chance happened to be a professional psychologist, but more so to me, he is a poet of immense beauty. And recently, the Nobel Prize Academy has awarded him award for the literature. But ironically, the Associated Press of Stockholm announced that Tronstrom, the psychologist, won the Nobel Prize. But Tronstrom won the Nobel Prize not for his psychological works, but for his part-time interests and activities which were close to his heart, that is his poetry. Tronstrom was born in Stockholm in 1931 and raised by his mother, who was a school teacher. Following after the divorce of his mother with his father, he lived and brought up by his mother. He received his secondary education at Södra Latin School in Stockholm. My pronunciation may be slightly different because I do not know Swede. My only understanding is that of English language. So there may be a slight difference in pronunciation, but not in the content. It was at the secondary school at Södra Latin School in Stockholm that the seeds that were already there in Tronstrom begin to sprout in the form of poetry. In addition to selected journal publications, his first collection of poems, that is 17 poems, were published in 1954 at the age of 23. Later he continued his education along with his primary interest in poetry at Stockholm University and graduated in 1966. Graduated in 1956 as psychologist. And he had additionally studied history, religion, and literature. Between 1960 and 66, Tronstrom utilized his time, or put it this way, that his time was split between his work as a psychologist where he woke for the juvenile offenders at Rockstuna Center, that is the Rockstuna Center for Juvenile Offenders, and continued his interest in poetry. It was in 1950s that Franz Stromer became a very close friend with an American poet, Robert Lee. The two corresponded with one another frequently, and it was Robert who translated Franz Stromer's poems into English. And then the first publisher, which was Bonniers, released the correspondence between Franz Stromer and Robert Lee as Airmail, a work that comprises of the correspondence between Franz Stromer and Lee. It was published in 2001. Then it was the Syrian poet Adonis who helped to spread the works of Thomas Franz Stromer and his fame in the Arab world, where he accompanied Franz Stromer on the readings. The word Franz Stromer is a beautiful word. It comes from the two words Thomas, which resonates with the Gospel of Saint Thomas, the only disciple of Jesus who was sent to India and settled in the southern part of India, and the Gospel of Saint Thomas is most beautiful. The other word transformer, to me it comes from a word trance, who always lived in a state of trance, a state beyond mind. This was the inner state of Franz Stromer. And also it has resonance with transcription. When someone reads the poetry of Franz Stromer, immediately something begins to happen, a transformation. In 1984, after the gas tragedy, the American gas tragedy in Bhopal, Franz Stromer visited the city of Bhopal where the gas tragedy took place, and alongside the Indian poets Sachidananda, he took part in poetry reading sessions outside the city. A tragedy happened, but it did not affect his work. In 1919, nearly two decades ago, when in 1990 Franz Stromer got ill and got partially paralyzed, and that has affected his tongue, and he was unable to speak fluently. However, he would continue to write and publish poetry. Through the early 2000s, and the last original book called Great Enigma was published in 2004. In addition to that, Franz Stromer has tremendous interest in music, and that reflects through his poetry. He blends his acumen and poetry, acumen and understanding of the music, very aptly through his poetic compositions. He is also a piano player, something he has been able to continue even after his stroke, although he plays one hand. Franz Stromer is considered to be one of the most influential influential Scandinavian poets of the recent decades. One of the most influential Scandinavian poets of the recent decades, Tranströmer published 15 collected works over his career, which have been translated into over 60 languages. It is by no means an ordinary achievement. An English translation by Robin Fulton of his entire body of work, the named New Collected Poems, was published in 1987 in the United Kingdom, and later on it was expanded as New Edition in 1997. Following the publication of The Great Enigma, the Swedish name is slightly different, but I will continue with the English rendition, the Great Enigma. Fulton's edition was further expanded into Great Enigma, New Collected Poems, published in United States in 2006. And later an updated edition of the New Collected Poems again in UK this year in 2011. He published his short autobiography, Memories Look at Me, in 1993. Other poets, specifically in the political 1970s, have accused Tranströmer of being not including the political issues in his poems. He completely segregated his poems from the political touch, and that is where his poetry is known as surrealistic. This is a word that he has coined, and this comes from sure and realistic. I will speak on this in a few moments as I continue my work, continue the talk. Apart from being accused of not introducing the political issues in his poems and novels, his work, though, lies within the further development of the modernist and expressionist. It is a way of expressing himself, and it is known as the surrealistic language of the 20th century poetry. That includes his clear, seemingly simple picture from day-to-day life and nature, and it in particular reveals a mystic insight into the universal aspects of the human mind. This is the beauty, and that is what has appealed to me in Tranströmer and his work, that it is, he has taken into account very simple day-to-day issues, and in particular it reveals the mystical insight into the universal aspect of human mind. A poem of his was read recently in 2003, still 7 years ago, at Anna Lindh's memorial service. He was given certain other awards for his par excellence in poetry, that includes the Griffin Poetry Award, and now he became the 108th winner of the award, and he is the first Swede to win this award in 4 decades. The last Swede who won the award, the Nobel Prize, that was in 1974. although Transtromer has been considered a perennial forerunner for the award in the past years, but the award eluded him for many reasons. At the presentation of the award to Transtromer, Peter Englund of the Swedish Academy said that Transtromer has been writing poetry since 1951 when he made the first debut, and has quite a small production really. He has been writing about big questions, his writings about death, his writings about history and memory and nature are significant. After the award, not only after the award but even before, he was recognized by even the Prime Minister of the country, Frederick Rimfield, who felt happy and proud at the achievement of Thomas Transtromer, when recently, not only recently, when he won the Nobel Prize, but his life and works in general. Why I am interested in Transtromer's works, I have to explain. There are two realms. Firstly, the realm of the intelligence of the head. Indeed, that is not the intelligence at all. It emerges out of knowledge. The intelligence of the heart is the real intelligence. The head is simply an accumulator. It is always old, never new. It is never original either. It is good for certain purposes, for filling. It is perfectly good. And in life, one needs this. Many things have to be remembered. The mind, the head, acts as biocomputer. You can go on accumulating knowledge in it, and whenever you need it, you can surface it. It is good for mathematics, good for calculation, good for day-to-day life and the marketplace. But if you think this is your life, then you will remain ignorant and stupid. If you are only within the dimension of the mind, you will never know the beauty of feeling. You will never know the blessings of the heart. You will never know the grace that descends only through the heart, the godliness that enters only through the heart. You will never know what prayer is. You will never know what poetry is. You will never know what love is. The intelligence of the heart creates poetry in life. Make your life understands the emotional flow and organize them into beautiful compositions as part of life. It gives a dance to your steps, makes your life a joy, a celebration, a festivity, and laughter. The grace of the intelligence of the heart gives a dance to your steps, makes your life a joy, a celebration, a festivity, and laughter. It gives you a sense of humor. It makes you capable of love and of sharing. That is true love. The life that is lived from the head is mechanical. You become a robot, maybe a very efficient one. Indeed, robots are very efficient. Machines are more efficient than man. You can earn much through the head, but you will not live much. You will not live a rich life. You may have a better standard of living, but you won't have any life. life indeed emerges out of heart. Life can only grow through heart. It is the soil of the heart where love grows, life grows, and spirit grows. Thomas understood this in his early part of life, and he continued his spare time after his work with the juvenile offenders as psychologist, he spent his time in writing poetry and expressing himself in various ways. It is the soil of the heart where love grows, life grows, and spirit grows. All that is beautiful, valuable, meaningful, and significant comes through the realm, through the door of the heart. Heart is your very center, where while the head is just your periphery. To live in the head is to live on the circumference without ever becoming aware of the beauties and treasures of the center. To live on the periphery is stupidity. To live in the head is living on the periphery. To live in the heart and to use the head whenever it is needed is intelligence. Thomas Transtromer seems to have understood this. But the center, the master, is at the very core of your being. The master is the heart, and head is just a servant. This is intelligence. When the head becomes the master and forgets all about the heart, that is a stupidity. It is up to you to choose the master or the servant. Remember, the head as a slave is a beautiful slave. It has much utility, but as a master it is dangerous and will destroy your whole life and the beauty. It will poison your life's nectar. Look around. People's lives are absolutely poisoned by the head. They cannot feel. They are no longer sensitive. Nothing thrills them. The sun rises, but nothing rises in them. They look at the sun with empty eyes. They look at the sun empty eyed. The sky becomes full of stars, the marvel and the mystery. However, nothing stirs in their heart and no song arises. Birds sing, but man has forgotten to sing. Clouds gather in the sky and the peacock dances. Man does not know how to dance. He has become a cripple. Trees blossom and man thinks, never feels. And without feeling, there is no flowering possible. This is the blend that we find in the life of Transtromer. Watch, scrutinize, observe, have another look at your life. Nobody else is going to die. You have depended on others so long. That is why you have become what you are now. Now you have to take care, because it is your own responsibility. You owe it to yourself to have a deep, penetrating look at what you are doing with your life. Is there any poetry in your heart? If it is not, then do not waste time. Help your heart to weave and spin poetry. Is there any romance in your life? If there is none, then you are already in your grave. Come out of it. Let life have something of the romantic in it. Something like adventure. Explore, millions of beauties and splendors are waiting for you. Explore. Millions of beauties and splendors are waiting for you. You go on moving around and around, never entering into the temple of life. The door is the heart. When the door opens, there is blossoming, there is dance, there is poetry, there is meaning, there is song, there is music in life. Love is available only to those who go on sharpening their intelligence. Love is not for the mediocre or for the unintelligent. The unintelligent person may become a great intellectual. In fact, unintelligent people try to become intellectuals, and certainly that is their way of hiding their unintelligence. Love is not for the intellectuals. Love needs a totally different kind of talent, a talented heart, not a talented head. Love has its own intelligence, its own way of seeing, perceiving, and understanding life. Also, it has its own way of comprehending the mysteries of the existence. When you look at the poetry, the poems of Transtrong, he has his own way of comprehending the mysteries of existence. The poetry, the poet is far closer to it than the philosopher. And mystic is exactly inside the temple. The poet is on the steps, and the philosopher is just outside. At the most, he can approach the driveway, but never the steps. He goes on round and round and round. He goes on moving around the temple, studying the outer walls of the temple, and becomes so enchanted that he forgets completely that the outer walls. He goes on moving around the temple, studying the outer walls of the temple, and becomes so enchanted that he forgets completely that the outer walls are not the real temple and the deity is inside. The poet reaches the door, but the door is so beautiful that he becomes hypnotized by it. He thinks he has arrived. What more can there be? The philosopher is lost in guessing what is inside. He never goes there. He simply thinks, philosophizes, and a poet tries to penetrate into the mysteries, but gets hooked nearly. The mystic enters into the very innermost sanctum of the temple. Some of the poetry of Transtrong is indicative of the mystic insights. The way is love, and the way is a loving intelligence. When love and intelligence merge together, you create a space in which all that is possible to a human being can become real. A loving intelligence is what you need. Intelligence alone becomes intellectual. Love alone becomes sentimentality. But a loving intelligence never becomes intellectuality or sentimentality. But a loving intelligence, which is far more beautiful, never becomes intellectuality or sentimentality. It gives you a new kind of integrity, a new kind of crystallization. This is what the way of expressionism and surrealistic approach to the mysteries of the mind that forms the essence of Transformers. It is in this light I speak to you of the Swedish poet Thomas Transtrong, who has won the 2011 Nobel Prize in Literature. Peter Agnold, permanent secretary of the Swedish Academy, which awards Nobel Prize, said, "Through condensed, translucent images, Transtrong gives us fresh access to reality." Indeed, Peter is right in saying so, because although trained as a psychologist, the realm of the head, Transtrong kept the emotions alive the mystical insights alive. Through his poetic expressions, Transformer created a balance between the head and the heart. In him, the emotions and their expressionism attains maturity through the periphery of the mind. It is quite ordinary to be a psychologist. It represents the outer life. Standing on the periphery, you are trying the innerness of the mind of the person in front of you. There is a way, an art, to for it. To be a poet is something different. You are indeed entering your innerness. Poetry cannot happen if you are not connected to your innerness. One can connect to innerness because of any circumstances and situations. It is in that state a Khalid Gibran composes the Prophet, or Herman Hesse composes a Sitar, wherein the river becomes the expression, expressive and alive. Sometimes Sitar talks to the river in the form of his mood. So it is because of this unique way that Herman Hesse has created that aliveness and expressiveness through the river. Indeed, it is unique to train first for the periphery and then move to the heart and use intelligence of the head to express and represent the emotions and innerness of the spirit. Such is the beauty of Thomas Transformer. Early in life, through his profession, Thomas saw the synecdochal evasion again and again when he worked in the prison for young men, young offenders. They had committed something, but they expressed it in an expressive, in a passive way. It happened. Thomas says, I was standing there in a house with a lot of money in front of me. Transformer remembers this laughingly. The crime happened to them. They were victims, not responsible what happened to the money. Indeed, such a statement is the expression of the inner beauty and mysticism of Transformer. Transformer says the way you express yourself is the way you experience things. This is a very beautiful and potent statement. And it cannot come from a person who is living on the periphery alone. It is certainly who has experienced something deep within. Transformer says the way you express yourself, remember the words, the way you express yourself is the way to experience things. It is a fitting credo for a man who is both a psychologist and a poet, who lived both in head and heart. Transformer is considered by many, including his American friend Robert Lee, to be Sweden's premier poet. However, he spent much of his time with those who were not interested in his poetry. On this score, Thomas says that they are not at all interested in my poetry. Had he been a Buddha, Transformer would have been enlightened by now. Still, it is not late, Transformer. Any moment you can attain to the ultimate flower once you are within the energy field of the master. It is not late, Transformer. Any moment you can attain to the ultimate flowering once you are within the energy field of the master. As Transformer, who now works as an occupational psychologist for the Swedish government, says, a faint smile plays across his weathered face. No grand statements, no pronouncements. and all this statement comes through his wife Monica, who says he loves to perform, describe his delight in presenting his poems. Thomas feels delighted in presenting his poems, the beauty of a man of heart. And Monica describes this beautifully. However, Transtrammer seems to prefer his worn blue jeans, rolled t-shirt sleeves to a poet's manner. In addition to authors familiar to every American school child, Ernest Hemingway, William Faulkner, and John Steinbeck, the award has gone to several Swedes in the past. In 1974, the award was jointly shared by Johnson and Harry Martinson. They were the members of the Swedish Academy. The 18-member committee that selects the Nobel Literature Prize. And because of that, an eyebrow was raised. This is erroneous. In 1986, Washington Post published a profile of Transtrammer, who may be unfamiliar to many American readers, but his profile was introduced in 1986 in Washington Post. His works have been translated in more than 60 languages. This is an enough indication to know the quality of his work, not his greatness, the quality of his work. It is the seventh time in the past 10 years that a European writer has won the award, and moments after Transtrammer's name was read in the Gilded Royal Swedish Academy Award, Nobel Committee representative Peter Ekman went on his defense, because Transtrammer is once again Swede, and he says that it has been 40 years since this sweet winning happened. He says, missing by 3 years. It is not as if we spread it around only to his country. I think we were quite thoughtful about this, and it is befitting for Transtrammer to win this award. He uses the external reality, often rather grim, to reflect existential paradoxes and deep emotions. This is the analysis of the poetry, the works of Thomas Transtrammer. He uses the external reality while driving to and fro from the book. He is very observant of the minute things. So this is the external reality, often rather grim, to reflect the existential paradox of the mind, and mixes with deep emotions. Thomas is very restrained and sober. He likes the Bergman. He is like the Bergman of poetry. I think he will appeal to American readers as a poet who brings emotions and ideas out of imagination in a very potent way. His poems, The Half-Finished Heaven, was published by an independent publisher in Minneapolis. It was translated by his American friend Robert Lee in 2001, and since then they had been continuing the book, in keeping it in print. Another publisher published his books also. And Fiona McRae, the publisher and the director of Grey Wolf, says, and she was quite happy with the Thursday's recent announcement of Transformer winning the Nobel Prize. She says was a welcome surprise, but certainly not a shock. We thought he would won several years ago, but he did not. And because of that, we have trained ourselves not to get into hopeful, Fiona says. But it is strange when I heard the Associated Press of Stockholm made the announcement that a Nobel Prize in Literature was awarded Thursday to a psychologist who used his spare time to craft sparsely written poems about the mysteries of everyday life, commuting to work, watching the sunrise, or waiting for the nightfall. This is an irony. What an irony. Transformer got the award for literature because of his poetic genius, yet he is recognized by his peripheral profession as psychologist by Associated Press in Stockholm. Transformer is Sweden's most famous poet and has been favorite for the Nobel Prize for so many years that even his countrymen had started to doubt whether he would ever win it. He is the first Swede in the last four decades to win the literature prize. Transformer loved music, and because of his partial paralysis, plays piano with one hand. Transformer's surrealistic works are characterized by powerful imagining and images through which he explores the mysteries of the human mind. His poems are often built around his own experiences that are beautifully infused with his love of music and nature. He also writes about history, existential questions, and about death. On these topics, his book is indeed remarkable. All his poems manifest a sort of total yet intense inwardness that is very striking, beautiful, and typical of the man of awareness. Because of this, his poems have tremendous appeal to heart and easily penetrate the inner precincts of the reader. Robert Hayes, a Pulitzer award-winning poet, edited Transformer's selected poems. There are lots of poems written about driving back and forth to work. Every day you used to drive and come back from the room. So the poems reflect those kind of realities. The poems about dawn, poems. Every day Thomas used to drive to work and come back from home. And lots of his poems are written about driving back and forth to work. Poems about dawn, poems about dusk. He gets those moments in life, those ordinary periods of change and blending with his musical genius and play of the words that such compositions create a heart-rending appeal. It is a beautiful indeed to read through the poetry, the poems of Thomas Transformer. A humble and unpretentious Transformer has always avoided public political debate and stayed out of the public eye. He is considered a master of metaphor who weaves powerful images into his poems without much embellishment. His focus on simplicity is also mirrored in the way he led his life. A lot of great poets do not do anything but writing poetry. said the Swedish author Lars Gustafsson. Let me guess, he was the first initial. Lars, a long time friend. But here you have a man who has worked really hard his entire life as a psychologist and who has been writing on Saturday afternoons and his spare time, often in small cramped rooms. I think his readers also experience him in that way. His poetry is very elementary. It is about things that nearly all people share, such as dreams. Stephen Bergston, who wrote a biography of Transformer and published this year, said his work is characterized by a combination of the ordinary people, nature, and feeling that there is something secretive and wonderful. No strange words, nothing like that. Anyone can understand it and seem level. But then there are other dimensions, and I am speaking of those dimensions that seem to be beyond ordinary human comprehension. This is the reason that I have chosen to speak on the works of Transformer, otherwise I have neither time nor interest. But Transformer drew my attention because of his mystical insights into poetry. He studied literature, history, poetics, and history of religion and philosophy at Stockholm University. And his famous work includes 1966 Windows and Stones, in which he depicts themes from his many travels, and Baltics from 1974. After his stroke in 1990, he largely stopped writing, but he published The Sorrow of Gandola in 1996 with works that had been written before the stroke and The Great Enigma. For decades, Transformer has had a close friend, an American poet, Robert Blaney, who translated many of his works. In 2011, Transformer's Swedish publishing house Bonniers published The Correspondence, which I have earlier mentioned, and it is a befitting tribute to such a man of intelligence, such a man of understanding and mystical insight, Thomas Transformer, won the Nobel Prize for Literature in this year, 2011. Only this much on this score. Do have a pleasant day.